this beautiful well. Everyone have the handouts that we've been looking at for this session of teaching. We're still talking about influence, impact, and leaving an imprint through the crown. Represent what? What the crown represent? What the crown represent?
Power.
Power. Amen. What's the sense of represent? Influence. And what does the scepter represent? Authority. Amen. Authority. Man, we have so much the Spirit can teach on, and if we get an understanding, the kingdom of darkness will not be able to prevail against those that apply the word of God. And it's more than just knowing about the word of God. You and I have to apply the word of God. You know, we can't come in here and get these teachings and then don't apply what the Spirit of God is sharing with us. Because the enemy is going to check with you. I said he's going to check us even if we have knowledge. He's going to see if you know how to apply knowledge. He's going to check us. If we have truth, he's going to check us to see if we really believe the truth that we have. He ain't gonna let us go unchecked now. Alright? And so we have to understand that the Holy Spirit in us and through us, we already have the upper hand.
Yes, sir.
We already have the upper hand.
Yes, sir. Yes.
And so what we gotta realize that we don't allow the enemy camp to bully us. See, a lot of believers get bullied because they have truth, but they don't really believe the truth that they have and made them free from the bully. And see, that's where Deacon Plummer authority comes in it. Because you can try to blow up some stuff where power won't work. You got to use your authority.
That's right.
You got to draw a line in the sand and say, get it hit. You can't come back. And you gotta hold him from coming past the line.
Amen.
Not the Lord.
Amen.
Ha. Amen. Hey, glory.
Yes,
hallelujah. Yeah. Because one thing about the kingdom of darkness, it will try to duplicate or ditto something similar to the actual kingdom of God. See, that's why the Lord has been telling us in this hour that we are in, there's going to be a great distinction between the perpetrator, the arm of man's flesh or woman's flesh versus the power of God's authority. And we got to know this. God have mercy. Amen?
Amen?
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Bless the name of the Lord. Any questions before we take off? Any questions before we take off? Any questions about anything we shared in the past? Because we're going back to Matthew 13. Going back to Matthew, the 13th chapter. And then we're going to jump around a little bit as the Spirit leads us. You still have your handouts? Okay. Let's look at, I don't want to get to the second page yet. I want us to focus on influence. I want us to focus on, I want us to focus on the sensor. Sensor. Let's look at Matthew 13 again. Matthew 13 chapter. Someone start reading that verse number 24. Start reading that verse number 24. Okay, it says the kingdom of heaven is like a man who sowed what? Good seed in his field.
Yeah.
All right, keep reading.
But while men slept, his enemy came and sowed tares among the wheat and went his way.
It says, but while, verse 25 says, but while men slept, his enemy came. And sowed tares among the wheat and went his way. He sowed tares among the wheat while men slept, and then he went his way. In other words, the enemy is waiting for the sons of God, and it's not gender, to fall asleep. The church, not in a local assembly, the church in whole, the body of Christ, he's still waiting for her to fall asleep. Oh, Lord have mercy. There it is. So he can sow something in the midst of what is already planned. Oh, good God from Zion. And here it is. But y'all got to catch it now. We got to catch this. We talking influence now, Deacon Brown. More we talking influence. In other words, if you are a wheat, if you are of the wheat that the Lord placed in his field, then it don't matter when the enemy sows tares, because he wanna plant you around tares. Lord Almighty, to see what kind of influence do you really have. In other words, stop looking for a godly job and go where God send you while the tares are planted, so you can bring the influence of the weekend. Okay, y'all ain't talking yet now. In other words, you and I are supposed to be environment changers. God Almighty. You and I are supposed to have what they need to come in, not us doing it, but the Holy Spirit through us and changing the whole place. Hee! Hasha. Y'all gotta catch this, that's why we can't start reading too fast. See, because the enemy has a tactic as well as the Lord has a strategic plan. So the enemy has his own way of plotting. Come on now. It said, Bob, who slept? The enemy did what? He sold. Keep on reading. Hey, hold on. Anybody have any questions? Anybody have anything they want to add to that? Just the first two verses before we launch in. He's still talking in an agricultural way. He's teaching. He's referring to how the kingdom suffers. this is what he literally going down the path of, but we can't see it in that facet because we don't see a trouble or a turmoil in such a way that it would say the kingdom suffered violence and the violence have to take it by force. But when something is sold, opposite of what has already been sold, that is good. There's a combating that's going on. Go ahead, Richard. Somebody see you hanging around folk that look like they don't know the Lord. And he's supposed to be a deacon and he in the midst of those jokers right there. Now it's one thing if they draw you in to be doing what they're doing, but it's another thing if you can't influence or what they need to draw them over, not to you, not the church, but to the kingdom, to the Lord. And so you gotta deal with those religious-minded people. Cause they don't understand that that's where the Lord wants us to go. But we've been alienated, isolating ourselves, secluding ourselves from where God told us to go into.
God.
Go into all the world. And we've been staying in these consecrated walls, trying to isolate ourselves from what we supposed to have to cause them to come out of what we used to be in.
Yes.
God, that's it.
Used to be.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
You are the city.
Yeah. Of the world.
Well, so you shine.
Yes, sir.
He said you shine.
Yeah.
How did you
in
a bucket?
No, sir, how did a bushel?
Well, you saying you put on the stand and shine.
Yeah.
So now shine.
That's right.
That was that reason.
That's right.
Jerry was with our life.
Yes, sir.
To others.
Yes, sir.
Then it's made so. I'm the same thing.
Think that's influence, right? So salty that they will want to drink from. Did y'all get that? I'll give y'all a quick example. I don't know what Mo experienced when he went to the national ball, the baseball game, went to a football game, and we had sweet seats. And all of the food was free, but the drinks you had to pay for. Now, understand this, man. They already had, they had something in place to make up for the food being free. So along those suites out in the lobby, when you walk through, get around to your suites, they had big bowls of peanuts. That was salty. Here it is. And before they served you the main course, they had peanuts and all of that type of things out there that will entice your thirst. Your thirst. And so you would want something to drink. And we ain't talking about no dollar and a half, or $2, $2 and a half, $3, or $3 and a half, $4, $4. We talk about $5 and $6. I ain't talking about alcoholic beverages. I'm just talking about little 12-ounce cans of sodas. And so that little bit of food that they gave you didn't add up to you drinking if you ate all them peanuts. Lord have mercy. In other words, they were trying to get you to drink. Hey, glory. Glory. I'm trying to hold on, Deacon Smith Mothers. I'm trying to hold on. But I want to get to the Samaritan woman at the well so bad I'm trying to push the Holy Spirit. And they wanted to entice your thirst so you could pay all that money for something to drink. So when was the last time the Lord used you by the Holy Spirit to entice someone to drink from the fountain of the Holy Spirit? Good God Almighty. Anyone else? Anyone else have anything? All right, keep reading, Dee. Verse 26. What 26 say? See, this is an end time prophecy, but it's also what we can glean from now. Let's not quickly haste to the end yet. Because there is a harvest that needs to be harvested. And there are some laborers that need to be sent into the field from the Lord of the harvest. Shepherds never beget sheep. sheep. Sheep beget sheep. And so when you understand that right there, you don't look for a shepherd to beget a sheep. So the weed in the tab, it takes someone that is skilled to even think about messing with the tail that's with the wheat. You gotta wait until, come on now. There it is. It's so unpacking it. It's so unpacking that parable that we sometimes miss. Because the tails are representing who? Come on, who? Huh? Oh, okay. Representing who? Okay, the darkness, the enemy, but, huh? Daniel, that's what we're looking for. Because see, we can make this, we need to make this applicable. Okay? All right, the unbelievers, unsaved. And the weed is representing who? All right, can we take another thought? Could we say, hold on. Could we say it could be representing, the wheat could be the Jewish people, and the tails could have been the Gentiles? Huh? Non-Jewish people. Or non-believers. Huh? Okay? All right? So wait until the skilled gardener say now is harvest time. Are y'all tracking? Okay? Just because the enemy planted or sold something doesn't mean that what he plotted is going to advance on what God has established. The enemy planned. Okay? He purposely do certain things in your life and my life. But if we are being governed and guided by truth and by the spirit of truth, when he sow or plant. Some of y'all tracking. Even though that he's so implanted, he still don't have an advantage on us because we're being guided and governed by the spirit of truth. So don't you quickly try to uproot the tail. Get back. Anybody have anything else? Get back to the scripture. We still got some ways to go. God, man. My God. 28 says. What 28 says, D?
28, he said unto him, hey, enemy had done this. The servant said unto him, will thou then let me go and gather them up?
What did he say?
But he said, no. That's why you keep gathering up the tail. Let's go to them until the harvest. And in that time of harvest, I will say to the people, gather you together for the tail, and bind them in bundles to burn them, but gather the wheat to my heart.
Good Lord, man. Verse 30, man, says a lot. Verse 30 says a lot. Mm-hmm. He said, let both of them go together until the harvest. He said, let both of them grow together until the harvest. Oh, hold on. Do y'all see tares being some tears in your life. There are times where you and I need tears. Hasha. Because, what are you saying? Because there are times where if we don't have anything to push us or press us, we'll remain complacent.
That's right. That's right.
Do we really need that to do? Yes. Not that, hold on. Not that the Lord purposely sometimes allow the tail to be there. If that's where it has, this how it has been orchestrated. Because he could have eliminated Lucifer. But he said no. He still have a purpose being cast out of heaven. Come on now. Now I'm going to place him to let him know that my children are going to kick him too. Good God Almighty. In other words, they have the ability when I cast you down to even trample on you, trample on you to let you know you should stay in heaven. Good God Almighty. And stay with them. But you're more afraid of the enemy, not knowing that he's more afraid of you when you walk in dominion than you are afraid of him by him being an unemployed cherub. Come on, have mercy. Hey, go. When you and I walk in our authentic DNA, Satan has nothing in us. Somebody might have heard that. See, Jesus told